Hello to all of our children preparing for confirmation and your first Holy Eucharist. We are going to work together on session two of your preparation to receive communion, the Holy Eucharist. Let's get started. You are working through a book called Signs of Grace. You are loved. Now we are in this video, working through session two. So that is the section in your book that has the light blue lines across the top of it. And so look for that in your book. This session is called the Last Supper. And we're going to learn more about how the Mass is connected to the Last Supper. Every time we go to Mass, we join Jesus at the Last Supper and we receive his body and blood that he gave to all his disciples at that Last Supper. What a special privilege and blessing it is to go to Mass and, when you're ready, to receive Holy Communion. Be sure and have your student guide. So that's the cover with the dark blue border, Signs of Grace, and then your activity book that has a light blue cover on it. If your parents have not yet picked up your books from the church office, please remind them to do so. It's so important for you to have your books so that you can read through them and do the worksheets and go back over it and review what might be confusing. So all the books have been put in envelopes and they're in the back of the church in the sacristy where Father gets ready for Mass, and you can just ask to have that given to you before or after Mass on the weekend, or your parents can stop by the parish office and you can pick them up that way as well. So I've also recorded this PowerPoint presentation that walks you through the main points of each of these sessions and gives you some ideas about how to complete them and what's most important. And then sometimes I'm going to be sending out additional crafts or activities through email to give you other options. And hopefully those are going to be fun and help you learn as well. Remember, if you or your parents have any questions, please ask them to contact me. I am very happy to meet with you. We can meet in person, over a phone call. I can answer email questions. We could set up a Zoom meeting with you and your family. If there's any way I can help you, please have your parents reach out to me. All right, your Signs of Grace, You Are Loved, your student guide, is your tool for your preparation. So please pay attention, work hard, spend time with each lesson. That's a sign. That's a sign that you're ready to receive the sacrament, when you have enough interest and willingness to stick with the preparation. So make that choice. And remember that when I encourage you to pause the screen and spend some time in your own reflection or working through things, please do that. And I encourage you to have your parent or grandparent or godparent or another important adult in your life, work with them. Have them sit with you maybe and go through, or else go through your chapter again with that special adult, and then you can really learn this material. So each session has a special structure, and that's going to be typical of every session we go through with this Eucharist preparation. We're going to start with prayer and an introduction, then we're going to hear from the Bible, then you're going to learn more about your faith and do some did you know activities, and then you'll have a chance to do some worksheets that help you reinforce what you've learned. Then we'll do a recall and reflect, which is kind of a review of what we've learned. You'll hear about a saint, and then you get to read a story that's a made-up story of two kids called Nick and Samantha from a made-up town called Hope Springs. And those stories teach you a lesson that connects to the chapter, but in a fun and different way. So I do hope you enjoy that. All right, I think we're ready to get started. As we start our prayer, and in this session called the Last Supper, I want you to turn to page 19, and then you can read along and pray this prayer with me. Because remember, prayer isn't something we watch. Prayer is something we do. And so I'm going to lead you in this beautiful short prayer to Jesus. and invite you to truly pray along with me. So let's begin in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross and rising from the dead to save me from my sins. Thank you for giving me your body and blood in the Eucharist. Please help me to always stay close to you. Amen. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. What a beautiful prayer, reminding us of what we have to thank Jesus for and how we can ask for his help so that we can grow to be holier disciples of Jesus. So ask the Holy Spirit to be with you as we begin to learn about the Last Supper. Our introduction on page 19, just along the side next to the prayer, asks you to think about your favorite food. Well, I've put pictures here of some of my favorite foods, including, oh, I love having salmon for dinner, and that looks like a delicious one with asparagus and potatoes. And I love fruit, all sorts of berries and peaches and pears and melons. Oh, I just love to eat fruit. But then I also love things that aren't so good for me, right? I love chocolate, and that chocolate cake looks delicious. And that cinnamon roll, that's one of my favorite foods. I love to make them and I love to eat them. Well, all this talk about food should help us think about what food's purpose is, right? Food is something that we need to help our bodies grow strong, to have energy to do the things we need to do, and to stay healthy. Well, that's all true about our physical body, but our spiritual self needs help too. And so God provides us with spiritual food so our souls stay strong and have energy and stay healthy, right? And the Holy Eucharist that we'll be talking about, that is the main course of our spiritual meal. There are all sorts of ways in which God feeds our spirits through our prayer, through reading his word, through other people, through the church, and through our actions. But a main course, the main way we receive Jesus is through what he called the bread of life, his body and blood given to us as our spiritual food. On pages 20 and 21, we read more about when Jesus gave us that spiritual food. So this is the story of the Last Supper that's found in Luke's gospel. You can find a similar account in Matthew's gospel and Mark's gospel. But we're reading today from Luke chapter 22, verses 14 through 20. If you're a super champion reader and you want to read more about what Jesus meant by giving us his body and blood as food, I also challenge and encourage you to read in John chapter 6, and you'll find a section called the Bread of Life Discourse in that beautiful chapter, and that will teach you more as well. All right, let's go back to Luke chapter 22. So you can read along on page 20. On Holy Thursday, the night before he was crucified, Jesus gathered with his apostles to celebrate the Feast of Passover. This was the Last Supper. At the Passover meal, Jesus did something very special. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said to them, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise the chalice after supper, saying, "This chalice, which is poured out for you, is the covenant in my blood." At the Last Supper, Jesus does something new. The first Passover saved God's people from slavery and death in Egypt. The new Passover, the Eucharist, which makes present Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, saves us from slavery to sin and gives us eternal life. The Last Supper was the first Mass, when Jesus changed the bread and wine into his body and blood, he instituted the sacrament of the Eucharist. And when Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me," he made the apostles the first priests and directed the apostles to celebrate the sacrament of the Eucharist until he comes again. We still celebrate the sacrament of the Eucharist in the Mass today. That beautiful instruction there teaches us the connection between the Passover. That's what we talked about last session. So you can review it by looking at session one. But it connects the Passover to the Last Supper to the Mass, right? So let's go backwards. The Passover was the Jewish celebration that God gave the Jews as they prepared to leave slavery in Egypt. And he commanded the Jews to celebrate it every year, right? And then Jesus, at that Passover dinner, he gave it a new meaning. And he instructed his apostles to repeat that celebration so that they could receive the benefit of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. At the Last Supper, Jesus was looking back at the Passover, but he was also looking ahead to his sacrifice on the cross. And he explained the meaning of it, right? "This is my body given for you. This is my blood poured out for the new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of sins for you." And so every Mass, we repeat what Jesus did at the Last Supper because he commands us to do that. And we receive the same gift of his body and blood. All right, so let's talk about it. On the bottom of page 21, there's a discussion point for you. At the Last Supper, Jesus gave the apostles something new and special. Discuss ways in which receiving your first Holy Communion is new and special to you. If you're not sure how to answer that question, one approach might be, well, what is the Eucharist? What is it going to give you in a special and new way? And another thing you might try and do is ask your parents or a grandparent or your godparents what it meant to them to begin receiving their first Holy Communion and what it's meant to them to keep receiving the Eucharist. They receive Jesus every time we go to Holy Communion. All right. Good work. Be sure you understand the key words that are on the side of the page on page 20. Those words are Mass and instituted. So be sure and read and make sure you know what those words mean. Pages 22 and 23 are called Let's Learn About Our Faith. And in this passage, we're talking more about the connection between the miracle of the Eucharist and all the other miracles Jesus worked and that connection with Passover. So I'm going to read. You can follow along in your books, read out loud if that helps you pay attention and remember. And then you may choose to read this passage again to your parent or to a grandparent or godparent that you can maybe have a video call with and teach them what you now know. All right, so follow along. Jesus institutes the sacrament of the Eucharist. Jesus performed many miracles. He walked on water, healed the sick, forgave sins, and provided food for people. These miracles helped people and showed them God's great love for them. They also showed that Jesus is God and that he can do anything. Jesus' first miracle was to change water into wine at the wedding feast at Cana. Jesus is the Son of God, and the Bible tells us that nothing was created without him. If he created everything, then he can change one thing into another thing, just like he changed water into wine. Jesus' first miracle points to an even greater miracle. In the Eucharist, Jesus changes bread and wine into his body and blood. Now we'll go over to page 23. The Jews celebrate the Passover every year as a memorial meal. They remember how God saved his people from slavery in Egypt. At the Last Supper, Jesus changed the Passover meal into something very new and special by instituting, or beginning, the Eucharist. The Eucharist is a memorial of Jesus' suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension into heaven. By these saving events, called the Paschal Mystery, Jesus saves us from the slavery of sin and death. In the Mass, in a mysterious way, the sacrifice of Jesus becomes really and truly present to us. This means that when we go to Mass, we are with Jesus at the Last Supper, and we are with him at the foot of the cross. We also share in his glorious resurrection and ascension into heaven. The Passover was one of the most important celebrations in the Old Covenant. In the New Covenant, the Eucharist is the source and summit of our life as Catholics because it unites us with Jesus's sacrifice of love. You'll notice in your book, there's a beautiful painting of the Last Supper. And then I've put on these slides some other beautiful artwork that tells the story of the Last Supper. All of these different works of art are meant to inspire us and help us think about how important the Last Supper is for our faith. And that's your question to talk about on the bottom of page 23. Why is receiving Holy Communion such an important part of your life as a Catholic? If you're stuck on how to answer that, I encourage you to think about, well, what does Holy Communion connect us with? The word communion means union with. Well, what does Holy Communion unite us with? That'll help you answer that question. And then you might also think about the purpose of spiritual food, right? If the Eucharist is our spiritual food, then that helps explain why it's so important. All right, so you think hard about that. Share your ideas. Ask your parents or godparents to share their ideas. And then also be sure you remember to look at those key words listed on page 23. Make sure you know what memorial means, what Paschal Mystery is talking about, and what a covenant is. Those are incredibly important words in our faith. All right, did you know? Page 24 and 25, we're going to talk about a really big Catholic word called transubstantiation. You might just try saying that, and then I'm going to break that word apart and help you understand what it means. Transubstantiation. That's the word we Catholics use to describe the change that happens to the bread and wine at Mass. So St. Thomas Aquinas, 800 years ago, used this word to explain what the Church has believed ever since the time of Jesus and the Last Supper and the Gospels. So the word transubstantiation tries to explain, what change are we talking about? What's happened to that bread and wine? So what does that word mean? Trans is a word that means change, like transport. Transportation means to change your position, to change where you are. Transubstantiation means to change the substance of something. What's the substance? Substance is a word that just means what something is, not what it looks like, but what it really is, right? So transubstantiation means change in substance, change in what something really is in its nature, right? The bread and wine change in what they really are because of Jesus's words, but they don't change their appearance. They don't change what they look like, but the bread and wine are changed in what they are. They're no longer bread and wine. It's now the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Right? So that's what the word transubstantiation means. So read about it on page 24. and see if that helps you understand. It is a great mystery. We don't expect you to be able to write a big paper about it or something, but I think everybody can understand that what we're talking about is a change in what it is, not what it looks like. On page 25, we're doing a different did you know? And this is talking about the words of consecration. Consecration is another fancy word. To consecrate is to declare something holy, to declare that something is God's. You were consecrated by your baptism. You were declared holy by the holy oil that was placed on the crown of your head, and you were consecrated to God. Well, in another special consecration, the priest, using the words of Jesus Christ, consecrates the bread and wine at Mass so that they become the body and blood of Jesus Christ. At the Last Supper, Jesus took the bread, he said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to his apostles as he said, "This is my body." He was talking about the bread. Then Jesus took the chalice or the cup that held the wine and he said, "This is my blood." So he spoke those words over those objects, the bread and the wine, and he changed what they were. Right? So at the words of consecration, the priest at Mass says those same words. But when he says, "This is my body," he's not saying it's his body, right? He's speaking the words of Jesus. And he's speaking in the person of Jesus Christ. How can he do that? Because of his ordination. Jesus gave him special powers when the Holy Spirit was given to the priest at his ordination so that he could take on the person of Christ when he celebrates the sacraments. So when he celebrates those sacraments, it's not the priest that's doing these things. It's Jesus doing those things through the priest. All right. Wow, that's another huge thing to think about. So read the words on page 25, read those key words again, spend some time thinking and praying about it, and then see if you can't use some of your own words to explain these two big words, right? The words consecration and then the word transubstantiation. See if you can't practice with your parents and then see what they have to say as well, in their own words, about these two great ideas that come to us. These aren't human ideas, right? They come to us from God. They're part of God's revelation to us in the Bible and in the tradition of the Catholic Church. And so we can trust in them. Even if we don't fully understand, we can trust that they teach us something real and something true. All right. Wow, we've been thinking hard in our heads and talking a lot. It's time to do something, right? So on page 26 and 27, you have two fun activities. The first is called Jesus is Really Present. You're going to do a dot to dot, and then you're going to figure out the code to figure out the words that you need to fill in the sentence at the bottom of page 26. And then on 27, you have kind of a little quiz. You get to complete each statement, choosing which set of words or word fits best in that. All right, so I hope you have fun with that. Remember, these activities and lessons are the main way in which you're being prepared to receive our Lord in the Most Holy Eucharist. So work hard. And if you don't understand something, ask. Don't just say, "Oh, it doesn't matter," or "I'm just going to pretend to know." This is so important. It's important for you to really understand it. And we want to help you. It's not a failing on your part if you don't understand. You just simply need to ask and we'll try and explain it in a little different way. All right. So you might want to pause this and work on these pages right now, or you could go and do that after the video is done. But I'll see you for page 28. All right. Page 28 is our time to review. So two ways to do that. You're going to write some answers out to some questions, and then you're going to review in a question and answer format some of the main concepts that we've been working through in this session. I put two pictures on the slide. The first is a beautiful icon of Jesus changing the water into wine at the wedding of Cana. And then the bottom picture is a painting found in the catacombs, the tunnels under Rome, that is one of our most ancient pictures of Jesus at the Last Supper. I put those two pictures together because the thing we need to think about is how these stories and these events in the life of Jesus, how they're connected. All right, so your first question, how does the miracle of changing water into wine at the wedding feast of Cana point forward to the miracle of the Eucharist? Are there any connections that you can think about? And then what do we learn about Jesus from this miracle? Sorry, the slide here says, who do we learn about? But you know that I meant, what do we learn about Jesus? All right. And then your second question to write a short answer down, how do the words of consecration change the bread and wine? So one way to think about this might be, well, who's actually saying those words? We talked about that, how it's not really the priest. Right? The priest is an instrument of Jesus. So think about how to say that to answer the question. All right, be sure to review those questions and answers at the bottom of page 28. And then be sure you understand. Once again, ask if you don't. We're going to wrap up session 2 by learning about another great saint who had a special love of the Eucharist. Saint Clare of Assisi lived in the late 1100s and the 1200s. She died in 1253. And she was an amazing woman. She joined St. Francis of Assisi, and she dedicated her life to Jesus. She became the leader of the women who wanted to follow the way of St. Francis. So she was the beginning of the nuns of St. Francis, the Franciscan nuns. There was a time when an army came to attack Assisi, the city where she and Francis and lots of other people, of course, lived. And as the army gathered around the walls of the city, ready to attack, St. Clare was the only person brave enough to face them. She didn't take a sword. She didn't have a weapon to kill people. What did she do? She took Jesus in the Eucharist and put it in a monstrance. That's that special holder that shows the Eucharist to us. And she walked up to the city wall, and she held that monstrance up. And the sight of that blessed sacrament, the sight and the feeling of power that came from the Eucharist scared those soldiers. People who are thinking evil and dark thoughts, when they see the Eucharist, they recognize the light and love of Jesus. And if you don't want to love Jesus and live in the light, you want to run away from it, right? And that's what those people did. St. Clare shows us the power of the Eucharist. When we see Jesus in the Eucharist and we love him and we adore him, we unleash that power of love in our lives, in our families, in our community, in school. So know that that same power that St. Clare could use is with you too. There's a memory verse on the bottom of page 29, and I sure hope that you use that in your prayer time and write it out on a piece of paper and put it on your bathroom or next to your bed so that you see it all the time and you can start memorizing this other piece of scripture. I hope you have memorized the one from session 1. You might want to see if you still remember it. If you don't, go back and work on that one too. All right, let's close with a prayer. I will talk a little bit more after prayer, but let's finish our learning session with a prayer. Right. So let's again take a deep breath. Remember that you're in the presence of God and that he loves you and he's so ready to listen to you. And let's pray together in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Jesus, we come to your table to nourish our souls, not with ordinary bread and wine, but with your true body and blood in the Eucharist. May the Holy Spirit fill us with your love And may we prepare ourselves to receive you in First Holy Communion by getting rid of everything that separates us from you. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's a beautiful reminder of how we can prepare every time we go to Mass. All right, so let me finish up our session two with you. On pages 30, 31, and 32, you get to read a story about Nick and Samantha. So this part of the story is called Boxes, and it tells about Nick and Sam with their mom going through a box of family memories. And you'll be interested to find out how this connects to what we do at Mass. So I hope you enjoy reading the story. And then on the bottom of page 32, there's some questions to talk about so that you can connect this fun story with what we do at Mass and what we remember about Jesus. So work on that. And that's the last part of session two for you. Now that you're done learning in your chapter, you can also find your activity book. Remember, that's the one with the light blue cover. Your student guide that has your sessions in it has the dark blue cover. So your activity guide with the light blue cover has some special activities for you to do. There's stickers, there's puzzles, there's a take-home page. So please choose something to do. You don't have to fill out everything in that book. Just choose maybe one or two activities that really help reinforce what we've been learning about. And then I do encourage you to cut out and use the flashcards that you'll find at the end of the session. That's just a great way to review the concepts that we've covered. All right, the big idea from this session, let's go over that really quickly as we close. Transubstantiation. Woo, what a big word. That's used to describe the real presence of Jesus. So anything can be described by what it looks like and by what it is. So I could describe the chair I'm sitting on by talking about, oh, it's made of metal and it has a padded seat, but it doesn't have a back on it. So I can describe its appearance, what it looks like. But I could also describe what it is, and that is it serves a function for us to sit on, right? So it has a chairness about what it is. Now, usually what something looks like tells us what it is, but not always. Think about something that we see every day. We talk about the sun rising and setting and moving across our sky. Excuse me. But you know that's not true, right? What that is, we're spinning, right? We're moving. And because we're on the earth, when we move, it looks like the things around us are moving, right? That the sun is moving across the sky, but we're really moving, right? So sometimes what something looks like doesn't teach us what's really happening, what really is. So when Jesus speaks the words he used at the Last Supper, excuse me, through the priest at Mass, got a tickle in my throat. The bread and wine change what they are, but not what they look like. The bread and wine look the same, but what they are has been changed into the body and blood of Jesus. How can this happen? Well, because of who Jesus is, right? Jesus is the Word of God. Whatever Jesus says happens. If Jesus says something is a certain thing or is a certain way, it is. His word works miracles. So that gives you another way to think about transubstantiation and this great, huge idea that's so important for us to understand. Congratulations, you've made it through your material on session two. God bless you. Good work. I know it's so hard to stay focused and to learn, especially some of these concepts are really challenging, even for adults, even for people who've lived this their whole life. So just trust in Jesus. Make more room for Jesus in your heart and your mind. Ask the Holy Spirit to guide you and to help you in this preparation so that you can understand and be as ready as you can be to receive Jesus in the Eucharist. Know that I'm praying for you. Know that your parents and your godparents and so many other people are praying for you as well. And we want to support you. So let us know how we can help you. All right, congratulations on finishing session 2, and I'll see you for session 3. Goodbye.